So I'm going to talk to you about something slightly different. It's about accelerating sparse linear algebra. So it's a paper called SMAS, Co-Designing Software Compression and Hardware Accelerated Indexing for Efficient Sparse Matrix Operations. Actually, we presented this work 2 weeks ago at Micro 2019. So let's dive into the executive summary first. So many important workloads heavily involve and make use of sparse matrices. Some of these workloads are like sparse neural nets, graph analytics, recommender systems, and the matrices used in these workloads are extremely sparse. When the matrices are extremely sparse, we need compression to avoid storage and computational overheads. But existing compression formats have some shortcomings. First, they require expensive discovery of the positions of the non-zero elements, so we need to locate the non-zero elements in the matrix, and we need metadata for that, and finding this metadata is expensive. Or some of these formats have narrow applicability. So for example, we designed some formats to be able to be to leverage structures like the weight matrices in sparse neural nets. So we proposed SMAS, which is a hardware-software cooperative mechanism for efficient sparse matrix storage and computation. So it has two parts, the software part, where we employ an efficient compression scheme that uses a hierarchy of bitmaps to compress the whole matrix. And on the hardware side, we employ a hardware unit that interprets the bitmap hierarchy. It scans it, and we're able to accelerate the discovery of the positions of the non-zero elements. SMAS provides performance improvements of 38% and 44% for two major sparse matrix kernels, sparse matrix vector multiplication and sparse matrix multiplication, over the widely used CSR format, which I'm going to explain in the next slides. So SMAS can be a highly efficient, low-cost, and widely applicable sparse matrix compression mechanism. So here's the outline of my talk. I'm going to give you some background on sparse matrix basics and the compression formats and their shortcomings. Then I will present our proposed mechanism SMAS. And after that, I'm going to demonstrate our evaluation results, and I'm going to finally conclude. First, sparse matrix operations are widespread today, so they're critical components of domains like recommender systems and applications like collaborative filtering, graph analytics and applications like PageRank, breadth-first search, and between-edge centrality, as well as neural networks and applications like sparse DNNs, graph neural networks, graph convolutional neural networks. So the matrices used in these workloads are extremely sparse. So I'm giving you two examples here. Facebook's and YouTube's social connectivity graphs have an extremely small amount of non-zero elements compared to the total number of edges that they could have, non-zero elements that they could have. So we conclude that sparse matrix compression is essential to enable efficient storage and computation. We want to avoid computation on zero elements, and we also do not want to keep the zero elements in storage because they're expensive. We will now discuss existing compression formats and their actual shortcomings. So, existing compression formats have the following shortcomings. First, there are some general compression formats that optimize for storage. They do not keep the zero elements in storage, and they avoid computations on zero elements. However, these general compression formats keep metadata for keeping track of the positions of the non-zero elements. And this metadata result in the expensive discovery of the positions of these non-zero elements. So I will dive into this class of compression formats first to give you some background. So the most widely used format is called compressed sparse row. It's used in many libraries and frameworks like Intel's MKL, the TACO compiler library, LIGRA, and Polymer, which are two graph processing frameworks. This format stores only the non-zero elements of the sparse matrix, and it provides a really high compression ratio because of that. It only keeps the non-zero elements and their respective positions. So let's look at the basics of CSR, and let me explain how it works and where the indexing overhead is coming from. So here on the left, we have a sparse matrix with five non-zero elements, and CSR has three arrays. The row pointer demonstrates what's the number of non-zero elements per row. The column index demonstrates the column index of each non-zero element, and the values array holds the actual values. So to actually locate element 3, we need to access first row pointer to find out how many elements are in row 2. Then we need to find out the column index of on this non-zero element, and then determine its value from the last array. So we need to perform three accesses to be able to find out where is this element located at. So these three accesses come from the metadata. So the row pointer and the column index are metadata arrays. So there are two takeaways here. So first, we perform multiple instructions to discover the positions of a non-zero element. And second, these instructions are data dependent. So we need to be able to find the row and the column to load the value of the actual non-zero element. So let me also show you the importance of indexing in two sparse matrix kernels. First, SPMV needs to perform indexing for every non-zero element of the sparse matrix to multiply with the corresponding element of the vector. I'm going to show you an example in the next slide. Second, sparse matrix multiplication needs to perform index matching for every inner product between the two sparse matrices. And what is index matching? So index matching is the process of matching the indices of the to be multiplied row and column of the two matrices. So as we see, indexing can be really expensive for major sparse matrix kernels. So let's dive into an example of SPMV. So in SPMV, we need to iterate over all the elements of the sparse matrix and multiply with the corresponding element of the vector that is dense. So our vector is dense. So in this case, we need to find out the column index of the non-zero element to be able to access the correct corresponding element in the row of the X vector. So when the SPMV requires indexing for every non-zero element of the array. SPMM is a bit more tricky, so let's see an example in detail. So we have two matrices, matrix A and matrix B, and we want to multiply the first row of matrix A with the first column of matrix B. We want to perform the inner product. So in this case, we have elements A and D whose indices match, elements B and E whose indices also match, and we can see that from the two metadata tables there, colint and rowint. But C and F do not match. So in this case, we do not perform the multiplication between C and F. So for every element, we need to find out their indices, check if they match, and then perform the multiplication to perform the inner product. So SPMM requires indexing for every inner product. To better understand this indexing bottlenecks in these sparse matrix kernels, we performed an experiment where we perform indexing using with zero cost. So the processor does not execute or a memory instructions or any kind of instructions that are related to indexing. We don't pay anything for the indexing. We have the metadata for free. So in this figure, we demonstrate the performance achieved by the zero-cost indexing scheme compared against the default CSR implementation. And we evaluated three workloads: sparse matrix addition, sparse matrix vector multiplication, and sparse matrix multiplication. And the results are averaged across a set of 15 matrices. And as we observe, for all the workloads, CSR, the zero-cost indexing mechanism results in performance improvements, especially in SPMM, where the intensity of the indexing is much bigger because we need to perform the index matching. So it turns out that reducing the cost of indexing can accelerate the sparse matrix operation significantly. Coming back to the compression formats, some specialized formats, there's a second class, some specialized formats that assume specific matrix structures and patterns like diagonals or repeated values. So think of some cases where our matrix is fully diagonal and we design a compression scheme that actually represents this matrix in an efficient way to capture the diagonal. And we don't need metadata in this case because we know that our matrix is diagonal. But the problem with that is that we cannot apply this kind of compression schemes in every kind of matrix. So if we design a compression scheme that can be used only with one matrix, we have two problems. First, we need to use it only for specific matrices. And second, we need to rewrite in software our kernels to use only this format. We cannot perform the multiplication with every format with one code. So our goal is to design a sparse matrix compression mechanism that minimizes this indexing overhead I talked about, that can be used across a wide range of sparse matrices and sparse matrix operations, and that is able to provide with high compression ratios and essentially high performance. To this end, we propose SMAS and to address the limitations of the existing compression mechanisms We propose a SMAS, which is a hardware-software cooperative mechanism that enables highly efficient sparse matrix compression and computation, and is general across a diverse set of sparse matrix kernels and operations. On the software side, SMAS performs the compression efficiently using a hierarchy of bitmaps. It compresses the matrix using a hierarchy of bitmaps. These are actually our metadata. And on the hardware side, we employ a unit that is able to scan these bitmaps to determine the positions of the non-zero elements quickly and identify them to accelerate the indexing. So software manipulates the functionality of this hardware unit using a cross-layer abstraction called the SMAS ISA. It's actually a set of instructions that allow the software to control hardware. So let's dive into the software compression scheme. So the software compression scheme introduced in SMAS efficiently compresses the matrix using hierarchy of bitmaps, and it actually encodes the positions of the non-zero elements using bits to maintain low storage overhead. So the core data structure behind our mechanism, behind our compression scheme, is a bitmap. So the bitmap data structure encodes whether a block of a matrix contains any non-zero element. So we set the bits when one non-zero element exists in a non-zero block. In a block, we use zero bits if the block is contains only zero elements. And I will show you an example. So here we have a matrix on the left. We divide the matrix into blocks. The blocks can have a configurable size, and we'll talk about that later. So the first block of the matrix contains at least one non-zero element, and we call it a non-zero block. And we set the first bit of the bitmap to 1. So the rest, some of the next blocks, contain only 0 elements. So think of this as like a contiguous array of 0 elements. So we form the bitmap this way. The problem is that this bitmap might contain a high number of 0 bits, because we do not want to scan these 0 bits to determine the position of the set bits. And this depends a lot on the actual size of the block. So the idea is to apply the same encoding recursively to compress more effectively. So we want to compress the bitmaps using bitmaps. So we demonstrate here a simplified example of the hierarchy of bitmaps. That's the mechanism we used in the paper. So the original matrix here contains 3 non-zero blocks. The first thing we do is we store these 3 non-zero blocks contiguously in memory. So these are stored in an array called non-zero values array, and these 3 non-zero blocks are stored contiguously in memory right now. Then we form the bitmap 0, which is the lowest level bitmap. The bitmap 0 contains the information about where these 3 non-zero blocks rely in the actual original matrix. So this one here gives us information about the fact that the non-zero block 1 is at the first position of the original matrix. Then we introduce another layer of bitmaps, another level of bitmaps called the bitmap 1. So bitmap 1 encodes a 4-bit wide region of bitmap 0 using 1 bit. So here the first 4-bit wide region of bitmap 0 contains one set bit, which means it's a non-zero region, and we encode it using a 1. We also encode bitmap 1 using another layer of bitmaps, which is bitmap 2. Bitmap 2 encodes using 1 bit a 2-bit wide region in bitmap 1. So we do this to introduce actually a flexibility and be able to apply different compression ratios to represent the matrix. So this way we can actually represent a wide variety of matrices with different characteristics in sparsity and the way the non-zero elements are distributed across the whole matrix. So one advantage of our scheme, one advantage of the hierarchy of bitmaps, is that it does not keep in memory the zero blocks. So in this case, as we see in the bitmap 0 here, we have these two blocks which are zero blocks, and we do not need to keep them in memory, because the bitmap 1 contains information about whether these blocks are zero or not. So we do not need to keep them in memory. We can keep contiguously in memory this non-zero block and this non-zero block. So let's see how we can actually find out what's the actual position of the elements and the non-zero blocks in the sparse matrix. So we need to perform a depth first search. We access the first set bit of bitmap 2, then we go into the respective non-zero block that it points to, we find the first set bit in bitmap 1, and then we find the first set bit in bitmap 0. The advantage I talked about, not keeping the contiguous zero blocks in memory, results in storage efficiency. And this way we can also perform fast indexing, because we do not need to scan zero bits to perform the indexing. So the hierarchy of bitmaps is also hardware friendly, since we can perform bitwise operations to discover in hardware to discover the positions of the non-zero elements. So I'm going now to present the hardware acceleration unit of SMAS. So SMAS employs a hardware unit that scans the bitmap hierarchy to perform indexing and quickly determine the positions of the non-zero element. First, it interprets the bitmap hierarchy used in software, it buffers it and scans it using bitwise operations to determine the positions of the non-zero elements. So the hardware unit in SMAS is called bitmap management unit. So think of a case where the CPU queries the BMU to determine the positions of the non-zero elements. So we want to find out where is the next non-zero element, where is the next non-zero element in the original matrix. So the BMU consists of four key components. First, it has some SRAM buffers, which act as bitmap buffers. So whenever we want to perform this kind of operation, we load first the bitmaps into the SRAM buffers. It uses two registers, the matrix parameters and bitmap parameters, to actually perform the index calculation, because we need the compression ratios as well as the matrix parameters, the dimensions of the matrix to compute the index. And it also has an output register that holds that where we update the output index computed by the BMU. It also has a hardware logic that scans the buffers, reads the parameters, and updates the output. So the BMU holds multiple copies of these components, multiple groups, and the reason behind that is that when we have two sparse matrices in our applications, we need to be able to perform index calculation for two matrices, or we might need two applications that perform sparse matrix operations, and we might need multiple copies of these components. So the CPU needs a way to communicate with the BMU to be able to perform all these operations. And this way is a cross-layer interface called SMASH-ISA. So there is a need for a cross-layer interface that handles software to control the BMU. So this interface is needed to communicate the parameters needed to calculate the index, like the bitmap and the matrix parameters. And also we need to query the BMU to retrieve the index of the next non-zero element. Therefore, we introduce a set of five new instructions called the SMASH-ISA. You can find more details about these instructions in the actual paper. And these instructions enable SMASH to flexibly accelerate a diverse range of operations on any sparse matrix. So we can take these instructions, put them in our software, rewrite our software using these instructions, and we can efficiently use the BMU this way and accelerate the indexing. So I'm going to show you a use case of SPMB using the SMASH-ISA, using actually the whole SMASH mechanism. So in SPMV, we need to iterate over all the elements of the sparse matrix and perform the multiplication using the vector. So in this case, in our algorithm, we need to iterate over the non-zero blocks. That's the essential thing. We do not need computation on zero elements. We just need to iterate over the non-zero blocks. So the CPU requests from the BMU to discover the positions of the non-zero blocks. So in the beginning, let's say we want to perform the multiplication of this non-zero element with the respective position in the X vector. So in this case, first we find the first set bits in every, so the SRAM buffers holds the three levels of the bitmap in each one of the buffers. So the bitmap buffer 2 holds the bitmap 2, bitmap buffer 1 holds the bitmap 1. So we first load the bitmaps there, and then we find the positions of the first set bits. So first we find these positions. So we're able to determine where is the non-zero block here, because we have these positions here from the metadata. we perform the index calculation using the matrix parameters and the bitmap parameters, and we update the row index to perform the multiplication using the correct element. If we want to find out the index of the next non-zero block, then we skip this zero and we progress to the next set bit over the last bitmap, because the last bitmap contains information that is encoded using this one. After that, we need to move from bitmap 1. We need to find these two bits in these two bitmaps. And we can progress this in parallel in hardware. So we actually retrieve the indices and we're able to index the vector using the BMU output, so we can perform the multiplication correctly right now. If anyone has any question in this, I'm pleased to answer that. So let's move to our evaluation results. So we use the ZSIM simulator. And in terms of workloads, we use two sparse matrix kernels, sparse matrix vector multiplication and sparse matrix multiplication for the TACO compiler library. We also evaluated SMASH using two graph applications, PageRank and Between Centrality, from the LIGRA framework. And for our input datasets, we used a set of 15 diverse sparse matrices and four graphs from the Sparse Suite collection. So in our evaluation, we examined 15 matrices with sparsity ranging from 0.01% to 8.79%. So sparsity means that 0.01% of the total elements are non-zeros, which is our really small numbers. So our matrices are extremely sparse in these cases. So we demonstrate first the performance improvement using SMASH. So in this figure, we demonstrate the speedup of SMASH and TACO BCSR. So BCSR is another compression, state-of-the-art compression mechanism. It's called blocked compressed sparse row. So think of the CSR format, and we block it to actually perform better indexing. So in this case, as we see, SMASH provides significant performance improvements over state-of-the-art formats, up to 44% for sparse matrix multiplication. So we need to back up our results and see where the speedup is coming from. And in this figure, we demonstrate the number of executed instructions of SMASH and TACO BCSR over TACO CSR for these four workloads again. And as we observe, SMASH results in significant reductions in the number of executed instructions. And the reason this happens is that we removed from the critical, from the actual pipeline of our processor, we removed any kind of operation that is done to perform the indexing. So we don't have anything in our pipeline that does the indexing. We just query the BMU. We are still on the critical path, but we query the BMU to perform the indexing for us. And that's why we reduce the number of executed instructions. We also reduce the number of executed instructions because we save storage. I will show that in the next slides. So we also performed a sweep through matrices with ascending order based on their sparsity. So these are the 15 matrices with the increasing sparsity. And as we observed in this case, for this set of 15 matrices, SMASH provides speedups regardless of the density of the sparsity of the matrix. So regarding storage efficiency, in this case we show the SMASH total compression ratio and the CSR total compression ratio over the naive approach of keeping all the elements in the matrix. We keep all the elements, zeros and non-zero elements, and we show the total compression ratio after using SMASH or CSR. And as we can see, for this is the mean, this is the geometric mean, SMASH is able to provide with storage benefits compared to CSR. And the reason behind that is that we actually use bits to compress the matrix to keep the metadata actually of the non-zero elements. And this is a major reason why we reduce the number of instructions, because we keep less storage and we step on top of less bytes. We perform computation on less bytes. We also calculated the hardware area overhead of SMASH. So in our configuration, we have support for four matrices in the BMU. So we have four copies of these components I showed you earlier. We have 256 bytes per bitmap buffer, SRAM buffer. And we need 140 bytes for the registers and counters for these four groups. So the area overhead is around 0.076%, which is negligible compared to an Intel Xeon CPU. So you can find other results in the paper, like we have a compression ratio sensitivity analysis. We actually sweep different compression ratios of bitmap zero. We also perform an experiment with the distribution of non-zero elements in the matrix. So SMAS, like the distribution of non-zero elements in the matrix, are a critical factor to the performance of SMAS. And we have detailed results for SPMM, as well as conversion overheads from CSR to SMAS. So we need to convert, when using a library and software, we may need to convert the existing CSR format to our format. And this has a conversion overhead that we need to pay only once though. And also we have an experiment where we have software-only approaches executed in a real machine. So SMAS can be a software-only mechanism, right? We don't need the acceleration unit. We just employ it to accelerate it. So I will now conclude my talk, and let's see the summary and the conclusion again. So as I talked earlier, there are many important workloads that heavily make use of sparse matrices. And these sparse matrices are extremely sparse, and compression is an essential tool to avoid storage and computational overheads. So some shortcomings of the existing compression formats. First, they result in expensive discovery of the positions of non-zero elements, or they're narrow applicable. So we're trying to deal with the first problem, but with both problems. SMAS is a hardware-software cooperative mechanism that efficiently keeps the matrix in storage and performs computation in it. On the software side, it employs a compression scheme that uses hardware, a hierarchy of bitmaps to keep track of the metadata and where the non-zero regions of the matrix are placed. And on the hardware side, it uses a hardware unit that interprets the bitmap hierarchy, scans it, and is able to provide us with the non-zero indices. SMAS accelerates performance by 38% and 44% for SPMV and SPMM over the widely used CSR format and across 15 matrices. We conclude that SMAS can be used as a highly efficient, low-cost, and widely applicable mechanism. Does anyone want to discuss? Or you're super tired? So I have some stuff. Do we have time? Okay. One problem that we identified is that when there is a crazy access pattern in software, where we need to perform, for example, DLU decomposition, and you need to go up, down in the matrix, so SMAS cannot be efficient in this case, right? Because we do not stream through the non-zero blocks. We need to do some crazy access pattern to access the non-zero blocks. And we need a different kind of acceleration unit. Actually, the software part of SMAS can be used because we keep track of the metadata in the bitmaps. But the acceleration unit works well when we actually have a streaming behavior in the matrix. And this is true for most of the workloads, but not for some of them. For LU decomposition, I think it's not. So the decompression is still on the critical path. So the acceleration unit is queried and it's able to provide you with the index. But this is still on the critical path, right? Because we need to insert an ISA instruction to signal the BMU to give us back the index. And this is still on the critical path. And the question is, can we remove it from the critical path? So as probably Professor Mutlu told you in the lectures, there is a mechanism called AMBIT, and we can perform bitwise operations in DRAM. And the question is, can we perform using the bitmaps bitwise operations to find out the actual product, whether the product of two matrices is zero, for example, to avoid this computation and do that before the execution, so that we know that we're not going to compute this zeros in the matrix. Another point is, like, our bitmap needs to be configured somehow, right? And we need to configure actually the compression granularities, the compression ratios, the sizes of the blocks, to compress efficiently different matrices. Right now in our work, we empirically did that. So, for example, I've seen that for most of the matrices, using some fixed compression ratios like 16, 4, and 2 works good. But this is not true for all the matrices, right? So is there a way to determine the bitmap parameters on the fly, the bitmap compression ratios on the fly for the matrix? What kind of profiling, for example, do we need for that? And the last point is, like, can you use a similar mechanism in GPUs? Like, most of the people right now in are using GPUs or accelerators to perform the sparse matrix vector multiplication and any kind of sparse linear algebra operations. And the question is, can we use a similar mechanism in GPUs to avoid, to compress the matrix or perform the indexing? If you have any ideas, let me know. So thanks for attending, and I'm happy to hear any questions. I think we're fine. Thanks.